I'm Noxious. I'm a commentator for Hearthstone specifically, and I commentate and, you know, cast events. So as far as skills go for commentating, I think it's a lot to do with eloquence, the way that you can explain the things that you see on screen for, you know, maybe for players that don't necessarily know too much about the game. But if you want to be a commentator, I'd say you kind of just start with it. I think it's a lot of passion, honestly. You have to love the games that you're casting, and if you don't, I think people are going to be able to tell very easily, so love the game.
So I've been a professional player before. I was playing for Cloud9. I was the captain as well of the team. And at some point, I just got invited to cast the desks and just trying to talk about the game and see how it's going on. And I really liked it. I liked talking about the tournament, about everything, about the players. And I like all those stories. When I'm commentating, I'm mostly thinking about the desk and what's happening. So who is talking, who is the specialist. What I'm trying to give the viewers from the very beginning is the big picture. And I'm trying to like tell the story of what is happening exactly and what does it really mean for them to win or lose in specific situations. I prepare for events like this just playing the game a lot and trying to analyze what is going on, talking to the pro players, to know the metagame, to know their choices before they actually play the tournament.
Insomnia is UK's biggest gaming festival, and it's, you know, recurrent. And the fact that they added Hearthstone to the mix means that we're going to be getting more and more of that in the future. Overall, the bigger names that we already know are going to have a big edge, but I really want to see some upsets, you know, some locals from the UK, maybe see them get a really big shot.
So going forward, I think viewers can expect a lot of top-level play from all the players, also the qualified players, a lot of great cards, great matches, and a lot of fun. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Insomnia True Silver Championship. I'm your host, Nimsh, and I'm here with Lothar, Raven, and Noxious. We have the last day for you. 8 players remaining. $30,000 is going to be spread out. Welcome back. Guys, Lothar, Raven, Noxious.
Yep.
It's good to have you guys.
Yeah, it is.
And how are you doing?
Well, it's the quarterfinals, and I'm really excited to see some of the players here. We have a really exciting top 8. We have some known names and no names yet to be blattened. But I'm really hyped for the first game between Colento and JJ. Though this is the first time we'll actually see them competing against each other, right? JJ made a name of himself by winning Seed Story Cup lately and the Time to Win tournament, and this is maybe his next chance to be in a grand final, but first he needs to beat Colento.
And absolutely.
Yeah, and Colento is a beast, as we all know.
Yeah, I mean, Super JJ was saying earlier, he's like, this is my final boss, right? That's kind of what he said. He said, if I can beat Colento, then this is the next step. You know, I he's on a hot streak, and he really wants to get that win against Colento. Whether or not he takes the entire thing, I mean, that's a secondary thing, but just beating Colento would be kind of an achievement in and of its own. So I think he's pretty eager to see how he does, because his rogue we saw yesterday went, you know, 9-0 through everybody, basically got completely demolished by it, and he's trying to get probably the same result to happen against.
Are we sure that it was the rogue used? Because we didn't have all the matches broadcast with Druid at some point.
He did get a Druid win.
But I think he's showing the fact that he can consistently perform. As we said yesterday, he's done really well in their previous tournaments, taking victories there. And then Last Hero Standing just seems to suit him. When you can just 3-0, I only need one deck at a time, it's fine.
Yeah, his first major win was actually at Story Cup, which was the Last Hero Standing tournament. But I really like his approach, where instead of just coming here to try harding, really, he's relaxing, you know?
But yeah, kind of.
On the other hand...
Can you say that about him? I don't think so.
He's pretty try-hard, but yeah. He does have... he looks laid back, and he's not too stressed, but he does, you know, he takes the game seriously, but he's not stressed about it, not too much.
Yeah, and the good thing for him as well is he could have easily been one of the eight invites to the tournament.
Instead, that's right.
He rocks up instead, or like, not uninvited, but just as a turn-up and play player. And he just like smashes through the qualifier, and now he's gone through top 16 to get to top 8. So he's definitely one of the names I would say could just go straight through and win the whole tournament.
He invited himself to this top 8.
Yeah.
Literally.
I like that.
And it's great that he's actually really fired up to face Colento. Because a lot of players will be like, I don't want to really play versus the best players. I want to play versus the worst players first to quickly get to the final. But JJ wants to challenge himself. And after winning versus Stanislav Sivka, he thought like, okay, Colento is the next step. I really want to win versus Colento. And it doesn't matter that much if I win the tournament. Obviously, he wants to be the winner. But if he wins versus Colento, he will feel like he proved himself.
Yeah.
It's definitely a good mindset approach. So instead of thinking, oh, you know, I could lose against Colento because he's such a prominent player in the scene, instead it's like, yeah, but if I beat him, then that's just one more achievement on his already growing list. So really good mindset for him to have to come into this match.
Yeah, but we should talk also about the other players that we'll have today. And Colento is one of those. I mean, I feel like Colento was one of the most talked about player, like in general, like
in the history of Hearthstone.
Yeah, I think like
we've done a lot of talking about the player for sure. Yeah.
Yeah, but I agree with Lothar. Actually, we should see the top eight because our viewers do not know what was going on. We had
three groups with three man ties, so we had to play those over and over again to have the final top eight. And as you can see,
ta-da! This is our top eight, guys.
We have some unknown names, which is Ness. That was the three-man tie from the group with Trump and Freaky. So they played
6-0, yeah. So 6-0 was 3-0.
6-0 was 3-0, yeah. And that, by having a 3-0 in the group, did result in the three-man tie with the other players. So Trump, Freaky, and Ness had to play against each other to see who is advancing from them. Each of them had one win and two losses. So it wasn't like one of the players was ahead there. So Ness actually won the tiebreaker and is advancing to meet against Legendarin, who had the first place in Group B, if I remember correctly.
Yeah. The one.
And he was playing Rogue. He was really exceptional with Rogue. Yeah. And Ness is actually playing Priest. So Dart might be trouble, but he won versus Freaky. And he won with his Priest versus Freaky's Rogue as well.
He actually told me after that match, because I was watching it, he just came over and was like, all right, you know, good job, Ness. It's great. You know, you threw, good job. And he's like, yeah, I kind of just God drew with Priest, though. So just got to try and do that for the rest of the tournament, and I'll be fine. So
he did feel him.
With a Priest.
Yeah. It's pretty tough right now. Especially if you're playing against players that have the Rogue Rod, so it's one of the other things. For Group C and D, however, there was in Group C it was already set up.
Yeah.
We already knew who was going to go through. But Group D, we had another three-way tie there with RDU, Ike Wonder, I think, and...
And the third player, Slitha.
Slitha was the other player, the Spanish player who qualified.
Oh, no, that was the group with Lefkoj and Colento.
Qualifier, right?
Yeah, Lefkoj, Colento, Slitha. So Lefkoj, Colento went through that group. And 6-0 Ness from Group C.
Then it was Board Control then. It had to be.
Yeah, that was Group A with Super JJ. Okay. Super JJ went through with 3-0. And the three-man tie was between RDU, AK Wonder, as you said, and Board Control. And RDU won that. I think it was a 6-0 with Druid, if I recall correctly.
He was mentioning getting Wild Growth five times out of six.
Yeah, he did say, I'm a really good Druid player now.
Yeah, but a very interesting situation was in Group D. Because that was a three-man tie, but this time three players had two wins and one loss. Yeah. So it was a different situation than in Group A and in Group C, because the players were having an advantage over the fourth player that was just eliminated in the first place. And it was a very stressful situation, I think, for everyone, because you had a decent result in your group, but it still might not be advancing, right? So it was
It felt pretty tough. I mean, we do, like, Slitha, I was hoping, would actually go through just because we saw him play in the online qualifier. He got through here. He got to nearly top eight by having a 2-1 score. And then he learns, oh, I have to fight against Lifecoach and Colento again.
Yeah.
Like, that can't feel good. And it was very late, probably a little bit tired in the first place.
And I'm sure that Lifecoach and Colento actually felt good about having additional
rematch,
games.
Right, because these players like long-term consistency over like a short-term burst of maybe a little bit of variance that can occur. But Slitha ended up being knocked out. We do, however, have a few names that aren't kind of the most recognized ones. And we do have Ness that went through. So, yes, we didn't get board control.
Yeah,
but we got two UK players.
Yeah. Ness and Vishal.
Yeah, I think the overall spread of the top eight, we couldn't have asked for anything better. There's a couple of UK guys. One got through from the UK qualifier. One got through from just playing through the turn-up and play qualifier. We have some of the invites through in the form of Colento, for example, in 6-0. And then we've got players like JJ and Legendarin, who are pros, who have just turned up to play, qualified, and then they're straight through to top eight. So really good mix overall.
Yeah.
It's so interesting that the stories, how the players got here, are so different. Where 6-0, Legendarin, and JJ had really impressive just
go in and get top eight, just go with 9 wins. Where RDU lost a couple of games, and he was counting on this 10% chance to have a three way tie. He was really hoping that the opponents will win and lose in a specific order so that he can actually have a second chance to get into the top eight. And he did it, he made it. He actually won the three way tie. So some really good stories. I like the story of Ness. Where Ness, a lot of people said that he has no chance to get it to the top eight, even though he was actually playing a DreamHack Winter. Not many people know this.
Yep.
And he was second at the previous Insomnia, which was local to UK, but still, he was second in tournament. He was in the finals, so he has the experience. Right now, we have international players, we have a lot of pro players, and Ness is still here. He made it. He won versus Trump. And the fun fact is that he was actually sorry, because he is a follower of Trump. He really loves watching Trump, and Trump was, he's kind of like mentor.
Oh, no.
And
oh,
he had to win versus him. So Trump was
no
like,
way.
What are you doing, Ness? Succeeding you.
Oh, goodness.
No, is he a subscriber?
Not anymore.
Yeah.
Unsubscribe because I beat you.
Unsub, unfollow.
instant yeah. Unsub.
Undonate everything. Just that's it.
Undonate. Give me that money back.
Yeah.
Recall the money. Yeah.
Well, when you think about it, he actually cut him from a prize. So.
Yeah. So he took the money back off him anyway.
Kind of. He denied the top eight. So yeah, poor Trump actually didn't make it. But you know, Trump still had a good performance overall, and Ness is playing exceptionally well. And then Visual, who went for the UK qualifier, even though he is actually Australian.
Yeah. He's had an incredible run, actually, to go through the UK qualifier, and then he faced Sottl in the finals of that UK qualifier. And then it was just every single hurdle, he was like, oh, I'm not expecting to beat Sottl, quite a well-known player, especially in the UK. And then his next hurdle was, okay, like, I'm here top 16, got to get to top 8. And then he did it again. So, you know, he must be feeling really happy, considering a couple of days ago, he was like, I'm just happy to be here and play in this final to try and get through. If not, I'll try and get through on the qualifier anyway. But to just like keep making it every single step, that's what he's just got to focus on. Just keep taking one step at a time.
I really like to see, you know, underdogs in tournaments. You call them underdogs because you don't know them. And then at some point, they go from underdogs to, well, an established player, right?
Yeah.
That there's like a transition that happens over time. But for that to happen very often, you have to get, you know, kind of that first place. But, you know, we're talking about that yesterday. It's nice to see, maybe give more recognition to the people who make it to a top four, even top eight, just of any event. Considering there's a qualifier portion of it, those who qualify, who end up there through the qualifier, they deserve recognition, and we've seen that happen in the past, right? You look at Kixo, for instance, his story was basically that of a qualifier player. He had you know, ties for a while as well, you know, with the King of the Hill.
RDU.
Got RDU as well, same story. So you have all these players that go through, you know, a very grueling process, and eventually they become established.
When you think about it, Lifecoach and Colento are the same.
True, but it was a lot earlier, I guess, so it felt different, but it is true.
That they were not known for streaming.
Right.
They are known for streaming right now because they are established player, but that resulted in them being awesome players in the first place and not the other way around. So when you think about the most successful players in the scene right now, they have actually proven themselves as good players, but people still think about them like they are the known players.
Oh, you're getting invited.
Yeah,
so
because you know, because you're a streamer. But it's the other way around, and people are kind of forgetting about it.
Right, that's
true. It's not the beta anymore when we had some streamers, and there was no scene yet, and the first tournaments were actually having invites on
basis.
I was
playing those. Just want to put it out there. I was in those.
It's
I
not like
how
back
well
in the day
that went.
We're competing?
That's what I mean, right?
Like, you were actually playing the first BlizzCon.
Playing? Yeah, if you can call it that.
Maybe a bachelor.
Sure. But yeah, like so I think overall right now that the scene is, you know, expanding, and the players that are coming in are players that are proving themselves, and that's getting truer and truer as time passes. I'm just glad that we're part of kind of a first big event for the UK, at least. It's getting broadcasted on the international scale. That's really cool to see.
Absolutely. So we have really good stories, and we have good money as well, because we have $30,000 prize pool. Right now, those guys are guaranteed $1,250, and they will be fighting for $2,500, and then $5,000 for the second place, and $10,000 for the first place. That's really good money.
Yeah, pretty good. If you're looking to get, you know, a first tournament win under your belt, it's a good start. You can then put that money aside to start focusing more on Hearthstone to keep pushing. Right?
I buy all the packs.
I think if that's something that should players do when they're not known yet in the scene, and you get some money from a tournament prize.
Yeah.
You should just use that to travel to the next tournament.
Yeah.
And that's it. And you should just be putting your name more into the scene, and there will be more Swiss tournaments, more open qualifiers that are that will be offline based, and I think that's the proper way of investing your money.
Yeah. And then you get a team, and then it snowballs, and then
you stream, and then everyone complains about you getting invites because you're a streamer. And
it's a vicious circle.
endless circle of violence.
That's how it happens. True fact.
All right, guys, let's lay out some expectations. So for today, again, we have the following matches. We have JJ versus Colento as the start, Legendarian versus Ness, Sixo versus Visual, Life Coach versus RDU. Who do you think is going to take the first one? JJ Colento.
JJ.
I vote on JJ, but that's because I'm biased. But yeah, I do feel like...
Didn't see that one coming.
I feel like JJ is just on his hot streak, and the momentum's on his side, and he seems absolutely pumped about fighting Colento. So that has to count for something at some point.
All right, Lothar?
No, I would say it's JJ too.
I will vote for Colento then. We have three JJ, one Colento. We haven't talked about Colento that much. We had talked about how hard it is and how challenging it is to defeat Colento. I'll still put my money on Colento because he is really stable as a player. He has a really good mindset, and he proved himself again. He is in the top eight. He was one of the invited players, but he went for the group. There was Life Coach in the group as well. All right, second match, Legendarian versus Ness.
This is a tough one. Legendarian's an ex-teammate of mine and a friend, but Ness is from the UK. So I'm really struggling here. I think Legendarian might take it, as he's just much more experienced, and he's performing really well this tournament as well. But if Ness took it, I'd be just as happy, because I want a UK player to actually push through. But this is the issue, that Legendarian has Rogue, and Ness's whole lineup actually doesn't do very well versus Rogue.
Home ground advantage.
Fingers crossed. But I think Legendarian's just, he's got the lineup advantage and the experience, so.
To be honest, I don't have a pick here.
You don't really know the players enough to make a call, right?
Yeah, I don't really make that kind of prediction when it comes to game plans, game styles. That's something I can't really predict in this situation. I know Legendarian from the phases of the era of beta, right? And I know he's decent. And Ness proved himself in the tiebreaker, and that also shows a lot because that was additional two matches, right? So he actually played five matches in this group. And that means, you're kind of decent, right? You had a 3-2 result, so it's okay. And I would say this is a 50-50 for me. I don't have a clear player that has an advantage.
Sounds about reasonable,
50-50. All right, so I agree with you guys. I would say 50-50 as well. The next match is going to be Sixo versus Visual.
Well, I would say that this will be taken back 6-0.
And I think the Shaman he has is very well built. Like the aggro Shaman we saw.
With the elemental.
With the elemental destruction. Yes. That is probably, this is why yesterday felt like it breezed past. Because every single deck we saw seemed to have this new twist on it that made it a bit more refined. And that Shaman with elemental destruction, the fact that there's a deck that looks like it's using that card to its maximum effect without being a Malygos gimmick. Like literally, not an all-in, I'm going to control everything and play big threats later on. No, an aggro deck that says, this is my brawl. This is the way I use this card.
Yeah, exactly.
It's beautiful. I really, really like that deck.
And you take advantage of the overload by playing cards like Lava Shock.
Sure. Yeah.
So free mana, destroy the board, seems like a good deal to me.
Yeah, and you deal 2 damage as a spare effect to something.
Yeah.
Maybe to finish it off or deal damage.
So we agree that 6-0 is going to take it. And the last one, Life Coach versus RDU.
Well, I can make a prediction that one of the G2 players will be in the semifinal.
That's a good prediction. All right, guys, so JJ versus Colento is going to be the first match, and we actually sat down with those players to hear their thoughts about this match and the tournament overall.
I'm feeling good, I'm just enjoying my time here. I came here through the last, to the open qualifier, arrived at the first day. Now it's an amazing feeling for me. I made some mistakes yesterday. Today I played really well. I can't really expect to win every game, but I'm just trying to play my best and play my outs. It's like, Hearthstone is so hard, you can just lose against any player if there's just not the right RNG for you, or you are just tilting and making mistakes. Just take your time, improve class by class, deck by deck, hero by hero, and you just have to enjoy it a lot. Like, this is the most important part.
Colento's a player that needs very little introduction. He is one of the very best players in the world with several major wins to his name. This year he's won no fewer than 7 titles and is the second highest prize money winner so far in 2015. With unorthodox decks like Priest, we can expect to see big things from him today. Glint is a very slow, deliberate player. He'll wait and take his time, assess what his opponent's doing, and try and paint himself as many turns ahead as possible so he can get in an advantageous position for the win.
Galanto versus JJ. That's going to be our opening. It's an amazing match. It almost feels like a final.
It could be.
Yeah,
it could
actually,
be
that's
final.
True.
Yeah.
That is true.
So we talk about a JJ. How do you feel about JJ's nickname? Because you say JJ all the time.
I do it a lot less now, but I used to. Basically, like, it sounds like GG, but a little bit less GG-ish, right?
GG-ish.
Perfect. I mean, it's got a little twist on the accent, but it's pretty good. It's an amazing explanation. And just because of that, I have to say he's going to take the game. It's just...
Right. So if he wins, he actually says JJ.
JJ, yeah, that's just pretty much
JJ.
It. Yeah, JJ, that's
JJ.
Easy.
It's
yeah.
So
and
French.
It's super JJ too. It's like in capital letters.
that may possibly work out. Yeah. What do you guys think about the lineups though? Because we haven't seen Paladin from JJ yesterday.
Yes, well, we only saw his Rogue.
We saw Rogue and Druid, I think, but we didn't see it on the
stream.
So. We don't quite know what's in it. It might be an aggressive version instead of mid-range. I'm not too sure. But the Paladin is still anybody's guess.
That's right. And from Colenso, we had Rogue, we had Paladin as well, and Zoo. So who is favorite in the matchup?
Well, the Rogue, I would say the Rogue might take advantage of Zoo.
Of Zoo, yeah, a little bit.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's not...
Do you think they should both queue Rogue? And whoever wins that matchup has such an advantage. Whoever knocks the other Rogue out could really swing. If they both start with Rogue,
well,
then they're like, I'll beat you
rogue,
in the mirror,
double
and then be favored elsewhere.
Yeah, the double Paladin might be kind of an overpowered thing in the lineup,
yeah.
Right?
Well, Paladin is so good that you can bring Midrange and Secret. All right, Noxious, thank you so much for joining us in the beginning. And now we'll be able to cast. First game starts right now, Colenso versus JJ. Druid versus Warlock.
So the Zoo should have a small edge over the Druid. If JJ won't pick up an Innervates or Welgrove for that mana acceleration, he has the Dynasty Aspirant, which is a short-term solution to the mana acceleration, but at the same time, it might not be that great against Zoo in general, like especially if there will be a Voidwalker into Abusive Surgeon, because that doesn't really help. We see that there's a Voidwalker, but there's the Abusive Surgeon lacking. But JJ has a coin and both Wildgrove and Aspirant, so that will be it's a tricky situation. Oh, and an Innervate, he doesn't have anything to Innervate in.
The only bonus here is with that amount of ramp, he can pretty much just be able to Innervate into out any sort of mid-range minion he's going to draw. So even getting an early Druid of the Claw out is going to be really difficult for Colenso to actually deal with here.
Now this is a tricky decision. He's playing into the Abusive Sergeant, but he always can follow it up with the Wildgrove, and he's still missing the creature that he wants to innervate. So it feels like he counts on not having the Abusive Sergeant from the Colenso not have the Abusive Sergeant, but at the same time, he can't really abuse the Wildgrove or the Innervate next turn, and he would like to use the hero power just to kill off the Voidcaller. So it's a very awkward turn if he won't be able to clear.
He could Wildgrove Innervate hero power.
Oh, that sounds so awful.
little bit of a commitment.
It is bad though, but still, I think the overall position here is okay. Like even if you just hero power here and kill the 2-1.
I think you should just take advantage of having the Innervate. You can just kill the Voidwalker with your Dynasty Aspirant and Innervate Palette Shredder. It doesn't feel that bad.
Is this not okay to clear the... You can just clear the board and be ready for... Oh, okay.
Is he going for Temple Big Game Hunter?
Yeah, it's a Big Game Hunter, yeah.
Already? Nice. But we haven't talked about this matchup that much. This matchup really good for Zoo. And even though it doesn't seem like this right now, Zoo has an advantage. But with this hand, Colenso having double Doomguard, it might be trouble.
Yeah, and the options are for Colenso, Mortal Coil, Power of Warming, and the Seeker, which we've not seen. That sort of came in a little bit with the Seeker deck, with all the
Seeker, yeah,
with the multiple minions and the Sea Giants and the Seekers. But that kind of phased out really quickly because I think everyone sort of decided that just more standard Zoo was actually more powerful in general.
I mean, the problem with the Reliquary Seeker is the fact that it's not stable enough in the early game.
Yeah.
And you can't sacrifice early game board control for Zoo for just to play a late game 5-5, one mana. This doesn't make the cut anymore.
Yep, I actually like this Savage Roar here. Can push for some more damage. Guards the 4-2, and yeah, you don't need Savage Roar for quite a while yet anyway versus two. You're more concerned with just keeping board control, and that's how you win this matchup.
This Bigham Hunter is doing so much damage.
Yeah, you just don't let the Zoo get ahead, and that tap means he just has to play Juggler into the 4-2, which definitely feels kind of bad.
Super JJ has good curve as well right now. And he gets second Saturday.
Yeah.
No problem.
I was thinking about not trading here because how many minions can the Zoo play?
Implosion,
but at the same time,
Implosion
would devastate.
I was going to say it before it was drawn, I promise, but Implosion would have been terrible there. Just have to throw the Doomguard. He keeps the second one, though.
The second one is still
there.
Massive.
Yeah, that's pretty good because Doomguard overall is a great card versus Druid as well. It's really hard to kill with 7 health.
Yep. Kind of just go for Druid of the Claw and Taunt. It's probably the safest. Because then that makes the Doomguard on board now, if it trades, much more manageable. And even makes the trade awkward. Still needs one extra damage to kill it off.
Like, even if you go for Savage Roar, it's just throwing it away somehow. Like, you can go for Savage Roar, Wild Growth, but then having one mana, one extra mana crystal doesn't help you that much.
Yeah, and this Savage Roar just isn't as good as the previous one because you just don't gain the same amount of value as you did. Whereas Druid of the Claw, and I would like just hit face, like put a lot of pressure on. You do have Savage Roar and you have a Shade as well, so you could actually finish. Oh, okay, even better. He's just going to go high.
Well, he has a second Savage Roar.
Yeah, exactly. I was going to say, like, the Druid of the Claw guards a little bit and isn't easily tradable. But yeah, I'll just go face. I really like this play from JJ.
Yeah, and Zoo can stabilize at some point, but JJ has seen Defender of Argus being discarded as well.
Yeah.
So it will be harder for Colenso to defend. And this is not what you want to do as Zoo. Like, you don't want to defend yourself. You want to have a big board and just win for that.
Yeah, and even at this point, double Doomguard might not be enough because the Shade isn't really going to be clearable. Afterwards?
Well, you can just attack face with the 7-7, heal the Druid with the Claw of Jamar, yeah.
Ancient World, that's a huge draw just because you can get out of range of any kind of shenanigans next turn. I wouldn't be surprised.
Problem, you have to trade here, right?
Yeah, you will kill one Doomguard and Hero Power the Abusive Sergeant.
Play the Shade.
And then you have still two drops for the next turn, so Savage Roar deals 6 damage. 6 damage, 7, and a minion from the Palded Shredder, so that's, let's say, 2, so that's 9, and 3 from the Shadow Exam, so that's 12. So missing 2 damage for lethal next turn.
Minion is probably going to die, but...
He can have a bigger minion from the Palded Shredder, which would allow him to make a next turn lethal, but that isn't it. It has 2 attack.
Yeah, that's true. And if he Hero Powers now, he can still Hero Power Shredder. This is going to be difficult because you don't want to, as Kalenta, you don't really want to run the Doomguard into a 2-1. But the Force of Nature makes it an actual, like, large threat now. So.
And you're not expecting a second Savage Roar that much. You've seen one, you can't play around the second Savage Roar.
You can make the assumption that JJ had some way of burst the damage because he played Druid of the Claw in charge. And that was a clear...
If he doesn't kill it, that's it. Because he tapped. That's enough damage with Savage Roar and Hero Power. Oh, wow!
That juggle
actually decided the game here. It was exactly 12.
I mean, this is still okay for JJ, I think. You can just heal up.
But if he heals up, then Colento has 8-10 damage. 14, a single PO ends the game. He used one Abusive Sergeant.
Have you seen one PO? Did he not throw a PO earlier? Yeah.
That was
he
the Peddler PO. Peddler PO.
Oh.
Oh, well, yeah.
So there's still 2 in the deck.
Still 2 in the deck, yes. And 2 Defend of Argus, which might complicate the thing, the game plan. So it's very annoying situation for Super JJ. And the fact that your 5-5 can be killed instantly by Doomguard if there's no lethal next turn. Yeah. Makes it even more complicated.
The only positive is that if the Doomguard goes into the Ancient of Lore next turn and obviously the Druid survives, he can just wrap it off to finish. So it soaks a bit of damage and just staves off the turn. Just for one more there, and he is going to go for the heal.
Yeah, it's not like he has more choice. Now the question is, what do you do with the Shade of Naxxramas? Do you just keep it for the possible lethal or do you try to avoid lethal yourself? He goes for the safer play, kills the Juggler there. Juggler would be annoying if there's something like Implosion.
Ooh, that's on it.
flame imp is not helping much, but he is not dead yet. Oh. Now he is in range, suddenly. Unless he kills the 5-5.
Yeah.
Oh,
I think tap into 10 you have to, because you also die to just swipe. Swipe hero power.
Yeah.
So I think you just have to. Or another Druid of the Claw, for example.
So if you kill, you can't play flame imp, because then you will be in range of Force of Nature. Just a solo Force of Nature. So just killing the 5-5 makes sense, playing Haunted Creeper and going to the face. You don't set up lethal this way, so Colento might be thinking, can I risk it? He only has 3 cards. He'll have 4 after this.
I think you have to play the Flame Imp. You have to play the Flame Imp because you die to the Force of Nature, of course, but you pressure the Druid more, and at the same time you need to kill the Ancient of Law with the Doomguard. So you need to set up the missing damage that you did.
I think you could play the creeper and ignore the 5-5 and just hope he doesn't have it. Oh, he's gonna play the imp.
Okay. I think the imp play is better, as Lothar said, because then you're not playing around Force of Nature, but you're playing around all the 4 damage cards. Like you play around Swipe, Druid of the Claw, Savageur.
Oh, like the turn before he played the Ancient of Law, I was thinking about if he plays Living Roots, because that's the additional damage that he needed to kill his opponent off after the Savage Roar, and he plays one. So, yeah, that's the additional boost for one mana that might be needed at some point of the game, but in this situation he needs to use it defensively. I mean, he might be using it defensively. Like, an example, next turn, if he will get a swipe, he has lethal, yeah, right?
Of course.
And the thing as well is he can Living Roots the 3-2, the Flame Imp, but does that actually change too much? Because you've seen both Doomguards as well.
Well, with this...
Even a power doesn't kill him now. So do you want to save the Living Roots? Do you want to play them as 1-1s and make your opponent trade maybe? There's definitely a lot of options. It's just going to force him... Savage Roar.
Well, this doesn't set up lethal for next time, so it's kind of an interesting move.
I suppose it sets up there's a lot of draws now. This Druid of the Claw, Force of Nature, this Keeper of the Grove, Swipe as well.
Druid of the Claw was lethal anyway with the Savage Roar, right, in the hand?
Yeah, that's true. Keeper of the Grove, I suppose, is the one that opens up.
Yeah, that's
not,
yeah,
not
yeah,
used
yeah,
any,
yeah.
right? So
the Keeper of the Grove, yeah, that's
an
very,
extra 2 cards.
That's a very good observation here. So now, do you tap? And that's the question that Glenda has to ask himself, because he needs to think about Swipe, of course.
Yeah. He's not dead
and
yet,
Keeper of the Grove. Like, he puts himself in the range of Keeper, and I think he can't really do that.
And also Living Roots on its own. That's the problem.
I don't think...
You don't play around
to play around the Living Roots, because it's a one-off in his deck, but you just play around the Keeper, so...
All right,
no
guys.
Tap from Colento.
This is the moment. This can just win the game, and it does.
Druid of the Claw.
Yeah, so this is a win for JJ, and it's a very important win because the matchup was good for Colento, but the hand of Colento was really terrible in the beginning, even though it seemed he's almost there. So the matchup was that good that he got super close to actually winning this.
Yeah, he had the positive of getting double Doomguard out, but he had to sacrifice, or he ended up sacrificing the Defender of Argus,
yeah,
which would have been massive in the matchup. If he kept that, got double Doomguard, and then dropped Defender of Argus, that would have been really difficult for JJ to deal with.
All right, so now this means that Zoo is out. We're playing Last Hero Standing. Zoo is unavailable for Colento, and JJ has to stay with the Druid. So he takes the Druid again, and Colento takes his Paladin, which is a secret Paladin.
Yeah, I think this is a pretty good matchup versus Druid. The minions are normally so sticky on board with the combination of the redemption and the way the secrets all interact.
Yeah.
And especially when you can curve into something like Noble Sack, even Avenge is okay. You really want like redemption minibot Cog Hammer if you're going to do stuff like that, just to make that minion never die.
I think with this hand, you just throw away the secrets.
Yeah. Cog Hammer is nice though, because you to deal with the aspirant. So he can trade into that and then reshield up and then kill off the rest of the aspirant if need be.
He might be thinking about keeping Avenge if he's playing two, just as a one drop, but he has the coin as well, so probably better to try to mulligan into another secret mini bot, or maybe the shield mini bot, or secret keeper.
Yeah.
That's why I combined
it. Is Colento playing the secret keeper version?
I'm not sure. Yeah. I haven't seen his matches today.
There's so many versions of secret paladin.
It's like you either play zombie chow or secret keeper. You want a solid one drop.
Yeah.
And Super JJ, Innervate, pretty good opening with Shade. He has a Wrath. So not bad.
Yeah, he probably really wanted to see an Aspirant. It's the one thing that can actually trade relatively well with the early drops from the Paladin.
So Colenso didn't get a second to drop, but Paladin always is a hero power as well.
Yeah. And, you know, you said it again, Nimsh. So well, there's the second two drop.
You probably still open with Shield Mini-Bots, unless you really value the coin. And coin is valuable in this matchup.
Well, the thing as well is, if you open Mini-Bot, then the Mini-Bot dies next turn, 100%. Whereas, or can die 100%, because of the Druid Hero Power proc and the shield, the 3-3 shade will kill it off and still be alive. Whereas if you play the Creeper, then you're almost guaranteed at least a 1-1 alive.
Yeah, that's
and then you Coghammer. You can't Coghammer next turn.
No, you'll not have
mana. Yeah, I think the Creeper's okay, just to have a minion on board.
Makes sense, especially because normally when you think of a shade, Druid doesn't want to unstall the shade, but if you give Druid a chance to kill minions with it, especially in this kind of matchup when you really want to...
You need to slow the Paladin down, don't you?
Yeah, exactly. Shapeshift face.
Yeah, that might... How scared are you of the Creeper? Probably very, actually, because if there's, like, say next turn, even, say, Redemption Avenge comes down, and suddenly you've just made a board that's very difficult to clear up without Swipe.
The Shade is doing some work here.
Well, he has the Wrath, so he can he can just Wrath the Avenge target.
That's true.
A very good setup. For Super JJ, having the ability to just outgrow the Shade was a very important aspect for him. And now you can see that Colento had to sacrifice the whole Hunted Creeper just to set up a good trade with the mini bot. So if there would be an Innervate for JJ, it would be so sick to just play the Druid Vuko in taunt mode. Actually, I would have just said that this is the winning play of the game. But of course, there's the Innervate lacking, so...
Yeah, well, he is a very bad situation with no 3-drop, no 4-drop. He will be able to cast Wrath.
Do you kill the mini bot? Oh, okay, he's gone for it. Because you are always conscious of Coghammer. And that would have been terrible if he actually let the mini-bot pass and he just followed up with the Coghammer that turn. That would have been really rough.
Yeah.
Colento choosing not to play the Coghammer just gets the 1-1 and the Zombie Chow on board, which again, he needs to build up the board.
That's a good pickup.
Yeah, it's great.
Unfortunately, it gets traded by the board, and Colento, I'm sure that he will take advantage of that, maybe even this turn.
Oh man, that curve from Colento. He was able to fill turn 3, like basically turn 1, turn 2, turn 3, turn 4, there is turn 5, 6 in his hand already.
To be honest, I'm really surprised that he didn't go for the Coghammer, because he wants to curve out on 5 and 6, right? So that means he will not be able to play the Coghammer at all in that time. And having Divine Shield on that turn, I think it was very valuable. And the tempo, like with the weapon already on board.
It's kind of weird now, because to guarantee like the best trade, he has to run the 1-1 in. Mm-hmm. And then Coghammer.
He's going for the risk here and misses.
Okay. I think throwing away one extra damage into that would have been a little bit better.
Yeah.
Because then, like, the Shredder trades, you can kill it off with the weapon like he's just done, but the Shredder lives. So.
Well, now he's able to kill the Shredder anyway, so.
That's true.
The best outcome.
Is that better out of outcomes, but.
It's not terrible, but, like, the best outcome was obviously if the Shredder would get shielded.
Oh. That's interesting. He's not playing around a Swipe.
Well, he is not killing the 4-1 because if you kill Shredder on your turn, you can't deal with whatever is being dropped.
Yeah, but at the same time, you take a huge advantage from the Divine Shield, right? You just deny a lot of damage. If there's a way of just ignoring the creatures and just dealing the damage to the face, I think that's a big deal. So
but you're forcing Druid to actually hero power here.
Yeah, this is kind of rough, actually, because normally you would really, really like to drop Sylvanas the turn before you're expecting Challenger to be able to just either have a good trade or potentially steal off the buffed minion, which is normally the 6-6 most of the time. But with this many minions already on board, and one of which being a Creeper, which he can easily spawn two more tokens with, there's going to be the Noble Sacrifice as well, and suddenly Sylvanas' chance of stealing something good gets greatly reduced.
Yeah, so that was pretty cool. He actually blocked... the turn 6 play from JJ. JJ is forced to just Wrath and Hero Power, which doesn't seem amazing.
Yeah, this is really rough, because then only having one minion on the board versus Mysterious Challenger turn, when they have Mort.
Oh.
And it's Cho. they have a really rough time dealing with this now.
Welcome, Lord Walker Cho. So who's hurt? Valor Control. I think it's Druid, actually, because JJ will not be able to kill his Valor Control that easily.
Yeah, well, those secrets are not being played. They're just being put
exactly,
into the game.
Just,
so that hurts the Druid way more than anything else, especially with those
Especially with his hand as well. He can just go Belchotarian, and there's still good turns. He doesn't need to use Muster at all.
But this was a good matchup to begin with anyway, so Colenso got an okay hand. He's doing great here.
Oh, that's a good pickup.
It is. It is perfect. I mean, he will not be able to play Belcher, but just dealing with Tyrion here easily.
Do you actually want to kill the Boom?
I think you do. It's just such a big deal to kill a 7-7 minion with your own 7-7 when you don't... It's basically like a...
Take one damage.
When you think about it, it's like almost like a divine shield.
Yeah.
And that's a great... Great opportunity, right?
Yeah.
And also you get like pretty good value off before there's anything like a BGH comes out. So already you've dealt with their Boom. You still have the 3-3 afterwards. And if the BGH comes down, well, you know you can just deal with it pretty quickly. Mm-hmm.
For JJ, it looks really rough. And I think the best course of action is just to play Sylvanas. And I hope you can somehow sacrifice it next turn to take something on board.
I think Sylvanas Aspirant's okay here. You kind of locked out. If you play any of these, sometimes it's correct to just give your opponent the spells, just because it'll get you far enough ahead, and then the spells can be a bit clunky for your opponent to deal with. But I think with this board, it's not like you can give Colenso a savage draw here.
And you
that's
going to
be a little bit dangerous.
You do expect Tyrion to come, and if you're lucky enough to pick up a swipe, maybe you will actually have a very good Sylvanas anyway.
Yeah.
All right, so is it Tyrion time into Sylvanas, or do you just kill Sylvanas on your own, or do you ignore Sylvanas, kill everything else?
I don't mind Creeper and the 3-3 into Sylvanas first.
It's Noble
Sacrifice. Well, attack with the 7-6, and then Creeper and the 3-3, because that creates enough tokens to make the trade reasonable, and then worst case scenario, you give your opponent the 7-6, but then you drop Tyrion.
What about just going for phase and playing Belcher? You might even go for Master for Battle. Alright, he goes for Tyrion. So he feels like he has enough minions to not be threatened. Is Noble Sacrifice still active?
Yeah.
It's not attacked yet.
But he can actually attack with the Shapeshift.
Yeah, he can, but... it's a long shot, right? There's still 6-6 on board, and... it will be very awkward for
Is Tyrion going to get the Avenge?
No, okay.
Let's see. Well, that would be really cool, right? Then he sacrifices Sylvanas, then he gets the Tyrion. That's a perfect scenario here.
Nope.
Oh, that's the challenger just got even bigger.
Huge challenger. And now the kill of the game. Can Sylvanas actually steal Tyrion? Because if not...
Here we go.
It's a dude! Nope. Oh!
10-8, though.
It's not terrible, but at the same time, there's still 9, 10, 12, 14 damage staring at you.
So he's not dead yet, right? Yeah, he's not dead.
Well, he can go for the Darnassus Aspirant to Druid of the Claw, which is not terrible, but...
That's actually a good steal.
What about Savadror? You sacrifice the... No, you can't.
No. You want to give your opponent Savadror.
Please, Lord Walker Show, why are you doing this?
Second mysterious challenger.
Do you just drop it?
How many secrets are there left? Second really Noble Sacrifice and second Avenge, right?
The fun fact is, now you have to think about combo. Because this 10-8 creature is staring at you, and even Lord Walker Show can deal damage. So if you just kill Druid of the Claw.
Yeah, he can kill Druid of the Claw and then run the 3-1 into the 2-3. So then Tyrion's still alive, and if you play Mysterious Challenger, then a second Noble Sacrifice should be there. So then suddenly the combo, although we'll do a lot of damage, I don't think we'll actually be enough to push through the taunt and the Noble Sacrifice
as well. Well, you have 10-8, which is going to be 12 damage.
So you can do 20, right?
And Lord Walker Show is 2, so we have 14, basically. You need just to deal 7 damage with the combo. So you can actually push with a combo.
Okay, that's scary. Not through Belcher, though.
Yeah, Belcher's great. Just 2 taunts, 5 health. A very good decision there. All right. Giving Master for Battle to JJ. Really generous from Colenso. But hey, JJ, I see you're struggling.
Have some minions. Keeper the Gross finally here, but I think it's just too little too late.
Well, it can kill the Belcher, but that still leaves so much damage on board. 4, 6, 7, 8 damage, so it's one off.
Would you silence some Wrath of Tyrion?
Yes, that was my initial thought. Then you just kill the Belcher, and you're still dead. You have the hero power, you have the hero power just to be out of range by one. Then you will have to pick up a swipe next turn, but first you have to sacrifice your own lower good show to not give your opponent
the lethal, which will be very difficult.
Again. It's a very tricky situation.
Well, he can survive, that's something. To see one more card.
Survive for a turn.
Time waits for no one.
And then play Reno next turn, kill to
Reno out of nowhere. He played Reno, then realized, oh, I shouldn't have put this in my deck because there's duplicates everywhere.
So JJ is just going for the correct play, and this is very important for him because he told me that he is mostly playing to play correctly. He's not that concerned about his opponents or anything else. He just wants to play his A game and not make any mistakes.
Now Colent is one off lethal, but he can...
Never mind.
Yeah, that can buff one of the minions easily. So just counting the damage, there is 10 points of damage he needs to deal. Easy. Keeper of Uldaman. This means that Colento is going to kill the Druid from JJ, and Druid was one of the decks that he was using to free all people.
Yeah, we saw him.
Well, he had a really rough start. We have to say.
Yeah.
Right? He didn't have a really good start, and then the low control changed so much in the game. I feel like JJ would have been ahead if that minion would have just been 1-1.
Yeah,
that minion would have been any other minion.
Troll Walker Cho. So. Poor JJ really wanted to face Colento on even terms, and then Lord Walker Cho shows up, is like, nope.
That's the thing, the Secret Paladin doesn't really have any spells that do anything that you'd like throw the game onto. Whereas Druid, of course, you look swipes, Force of Nature, Savage Roar, there's so many spells that are heavily impacting the game.
Oh, look at this. Really? He actually took Paladin instead of Rogue. Even though Rogue is great versus Paladins. He feels like his, I believe, mid-range Paladin actually has a good matchup versus the Secret Paladin. Because JJ is a huge supporter of the mid-range Paladin. We talked about it, Lothar and JJ, before Siege Story Cup, and we were just discussing what is better, Secret or mid-range, and he said that they are probably the same, but I really like mid-range.
Yeah, JJ trashed me with mid-range Paladin in the Time to Win tournament that he won, straight after Siege Story, so yeah, I can deal with that. That's pretty reasonable.
Very good that JJ recognized the matchup in the first opening hand and kept the Consecration even though he's starting. So he sacrificed the better opening hand probability by having the failsafe card with Consecration just to reset the board. It's very important to have that in your arsenal.
Guys, it feels like watching Walking Dead, so many zombies.
Do you feel you have to play the Peacekeeper just for tempo here?
Yeah, it feels rough.
Yeah, just because you know, as you said, you have Consecrate next turn, mm-hmm. So you do have a way to just clear up most of the board, especially with the Zombie Chow still down.
I don't think there will be a way that you will play the Consecration because Colento will just clean up the board with his Border Control right now.
So if you just hero powered, he's probably going to weapon down the 1-1 and potentially ignore the Zombie Chow. Yeah. So then the board would have been a Consecrate board.
The thing is, like, you have powerful 4 drops added in Consecration, and Consecration is good later in the game as well, like if you're behind, and you absolutely want to have tempo advantage before turn 6. This is what you are fighting for.
Yeah.
Because you have better end game, but till turn 6, when the Mystery Challenger is played, you want to be ahead on board.
Like, what secret did he play, actually? I just missed it.
That was Noble Sacrifice.
Noble Sacrifice, okay. Because this guards the Creeper, which is nice.
This might still be a good Consecration, anyway.
Well, the Consecration doesn't do much. That's a problem.
Yeah, maybe you just want Shredder down, actually.
Yeah, but the Noble Sacrifice is the problem.
Redemption being drawn. That's not a good hand for Colento, but he has Blessing of Kings.
Yeah, Blessing is great. Some Blessing. Kill the
Blessing
free one.
Of Kings.
Go face.
There are a few options here, but I still feel like Blessing of Kings will just be the best one.
Yeah,
he saw one Peacekeeper, so I wouldn't blame him just for playing Blessing of Kings on the 1-1 and just attacking face.
And would you run the chow into the 3-1 first?
Yeah, you just use weapon on the 3-1.
What you can do is actually...
Would you not want to throw the chow though? Because it's going to heal for 5.
No, you can actually buff the chow as well. Because chow will be then the best silence target if there's an owl. So like, obviously, you can throw the chow, it makes sense, and buff the dude and then go face with the dude. But what you can also do is buff the chow as a silence target and run the dude into it and just use the chow as the kill mechanism.
Yep. So a lot of potential decisions for Kalento here. He's definitely running out of time though to decide.
I wonder if he's going to buff the chow. Oh, he's got blessing.
The creeper, okay.
Interesting. So he values 6 health because creeper is a bad silence target. You don't want to silence the creeper.
Is he just relying on the additional health more than anything?
Yeah, possibly.
Because now the Shredder can't like hit in and say like muster clear something up.
There's keeper, so it can limit the damage on the creeper there. But with the Noble Sacrifice, the Shredder is not doing anything.
Noble Sacrifice is gone now.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, he procced it last turn, right?
Yep.
Yep, so Noble Sacrifice is gone. He can use the Keeper of Alderman to reduce down the Creeper and then trade in if he wants to.
So he can Consecrate next turn, and yep. This is a good setup for Consecration and follow it up with the Hero Power.
Yeah, nice long curve. The next turn, of course.
Well, JJ is in a good spot because he's at 23. The Paladin has no way of bursting him down. He reduced the Blessing of Kings value by half.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the trades on the board are not that great for Kalento, so.
And he has a good follow-up as well. He has Murloc Knight on 6. He has Tresilver if there's
an egg. Oh, an egg.
Kind of unfortunate to see the egg after the Consecrate.
Yeah.
JJ's side, you definitely want it down before that just to make it even worse.
Especially because Kalento might be only playing one in his deck.
Yeah, that's true.
The biggest upset is the fact that he just used a Keeper of Ulduman.
Yeah, yeah, that's... He should run 2 in mid-range though, right?
Do you think
he runs
2? Yeah, not everyone is running 2.
He is running a Murloc Knight as well though, to be fair.
You might run double Keeper, 1 Murloc Knight. Like, people still experiment with it. I don't know exactly what he has on the list.
So I think the most common I've seen is 2 Shredders, then 1 Knight, 1 Keeper. I think it's the most common, for, like, 4-drop setup.
Oh! Okay. Well, that's a huge deal.
JJ, a bit of a thumbs up to the camera there.
It's so that's, funny, though.
That's a huge deal.
It is great. It is a great card, but it's so funny because Kalento was getting that at Star Ladder. At Star Ladder, when Kalento was playing Midrange Paladin, he was getting Murloc Knight off Murloc Knight all the time.
Look at this board.
Comes back to karma.
It's actually funny that after League of Explorers, the Murloc Knight value got decreased by the fact that there's Sylphinly, right? And the Baby Finn,
yeah.
Right? So there are two more outcomes that are not great for the Murloc Knight, but there's still an option to get something like that.
Yeah. And just the second you get one of the second you get the War Leader as well.
Yeah,
like, there's a lot of trouble going down for your opponent if that happens.
Double War Leader next turn. Well, one of the frogs is going to die, but...
Old Murkai War Leader.
I just love the golden animation. Like, look at this frog. It's just catching flies.
And this is such a dead turn for Kalento as well. No Mysterious Challenger and 1 mana short of playing Dr. Boom, so...
And he needs to kill one of the Murloc Knights, because that's just too big of a threat.
Now, Consecrate.
Yeah, the Consecrate will now be horrendous.
Did you attack him first?
Why would you? Then the event will be kind of making it awkward for you.
All right, well, it's going to be the Murloc, guys. Is it another Murloc Knight? Old Murkai, War Leader. What do you say? Quickly, you have...
And this zombie chow got redemption. Oh my god, what a perfect outcome for JJ. One.
Got it! Yes!
Got it. Yeah, the zombie chow feels bad, man.
Just get that extra healing as well.
It is a zombie after all, so it makes sense that it comes back.
Yeah, it is true.
Even Dr. Boom, like, it normally feels good to put it down on a board with this much power on the other side, but when it's a Murloc Knight and an egg that the Boom Bots can go into. And then you can just do a quality.
Quality Consecration.
I don't think you actually use the quality. You just drop the Tyrion.
You think?
I think so.
Quality is not bad, like, even without Consecration.
Well, he would have equalited first if he was going to use it, right?
Yeah.
So then the Murloc's buffed at whatever health it is.
Yeah, exactly. I was kind of surprised that he didn't just play it in the Tyrion. Because you have good options like if you attack first with your minions to kill the bomb and maybe get a bomb on the egg first, right?
Yeah. Oh.
He's still going for equality concentrate.
Why would he have hero powered first? Is it in case like you got a charge minion or something? I don't know.
I guess to get maybe Bluegill to kill.
But what would that have changed? That wouldn't have changed anything though. He got away with it because the Murloc Knight, I suppose he wanted the egg to die.
Yeah, yeah.
But the he just made the Murloc even more likely to die with the one health afterwards.
Yep, I agree.
And Shredder into Kalkam is actually a reasonable way to fight back for the board. But I guess with no cards in your opponent's hand.
He didn't want to use equality, he wants to keep equality. Just consecrate to get the bombs out of the way and get the egg to die. Yeah. But he was forced, after getting a bad Murloc, he was forced to actually still use equality.
Yeah, I just think rolling for like a very specific Murloc from Murloc Knight is very dangerous. Keeper of Alderman's going to buff the 1-1 just to create a stronger board. This is what's really nice about this card, it's so flexible. You can it can happen what we saw earlier on, like, say, Dr. Boom or something to just bring it back down. Or you can actually just create like a 3-3 and a 3-4 for 6 mana, which is pretty reasonable. Especially when he's top decking.
Yeah.
Definitely. Like a keeper of two wraps.
Yeah. Oh, he can still play Tyrion.
He can still play Tyrion.
Well, the Tyrion is not that important in this situation, I think. Like those Belchers. Because now after you saw the one consecration being played by Colento, you just want to have as big board as possible.
Do you actually like True Silver Belcher here? Take out the
that was my ball. Initial thought to play Belcher and just the champ because you have so much advantage of having the weapon already on board.
The thing with Tyrion is that it just kills his board. If he dies, but you get the weapon and then you just keep.
Yeah, and I think with your opponent on effectively top decking and Secret Paladin doesn't actually normally run an Owl or any good way to deal with Tyrion.
Yeah.
So you can just put it on and say, okay, just run everything in. And there's Kalento. Well, looks like he's going to just concede after face tanking Tyrion.
That was tough. And JJ wins with his midrange Paladin. That was an impressive win.
Oh my god, I hope this series comes down to the Rogue Mirror. Because you'd have to say Kalento's Rogue should, on paper, clean up JJ's Paladin. And then it will just be Rogue v Rogue for the final, which is going to be great.
And this is an elimination match. If Colento loses here, he's out of the top 8.
Yep, he's single elimination. Yep.
So Colento doesn't have the coin, but he has a prep. And to be honest, in most situations, I would like to keep the prep because it's so important to get the prep sprint.
Yep.
Against control matchups, and Colento keeps it. Oh my god!
So important to get it.
So important to get the prep sprint because it brings so much value to the longer game.
Yeah.
And you need to have that access to get those saps, to get those violet teachers in time. So it's so important.
And the saps are going to be really big because even for. To just say Tyrion pretty much just isn't in your deck anymore, because it may as well not be. A lot of the time you can't afford to just drop Tyrion and then 2 mana to deal with it.
2 mana gain next turn, is it?
Yeah, exactly.
Card.
If he's got a big board, then Tyrion's a lot better, of course, because there's still multiple threats, but trying to drop is similar to the way like mid-range Hunter plays versus Rogue. If you get to turn 6, you've got nothing, but you have high main, you almost never play high main.
Yeah.
Because if you've not seen any saps, it's just massive tempo loss.
So this is going to be interesting, because overall this matchup is great for Colento. And as Lothar mentioned, there is this sprint in preparation, but JJ is having a really aggressive hand. So JJ will try to play the beatdown game. He will lose the long game. So he will try to rush Colento down and double Juggler opening into a possible Aldor into Piloted Shredder is a really good opening. But
how dangerous do you feel of just going deadly poison here and then just saying keep build up the board next turn, like I dare you, like is that going to make the Rogue take too much damage here, or is that just good to sort of nullify Super JJ's next turn?
Don't you want to bluff that you don't have?
I was thinking about the Blade Flurry and
I mean you could just commit and just say right, 2 jugglers gone, which is fine. I just wonder if you wanted to maybe be a bit more dangerous and bait out a bit more value.
I don't think so because the single Masterful Battle just deals so much damage.
Yeah, it's 6 that, well 7 with the weapon, right? Plus another 6 from the actual jugglers.
And
so.
Especially that your plan is to play sprint on turn 4. It's important to clear it before that.
Okay, so this is going to be prep sprint. I'm just going to refill Colento's hand here and give him much more options to deal with whatever JJ's going to do.
It isn't tempo loss, but it does provide you with great cards.
And if you look as well, he's got Fan of Knives for a muster. He's got Sap for any of the bigger creatures.
Didn't
and even Lotheb as well. He's just a good body to just lock out some potential turns later on, I guess, to say, a Consecrate or a Quality.
Oh, that was a backstab.
Backstab, yeah. He just needed something because even though those cards are great, he couldn't combo them that well. He needed something like a backstab prep to be able to play free cards. This is why Rogue is good. There are so many free cards you can play.
This is a good turn for backstab agent on the zombie chow. Hero power to kill the 1/1, so you leave a 3/3 that challenges the Pilot Shredder, because you don't want to play Lotheb into that that board at all, because it dies to the Pilot Shredder and the 1/1, and imagine if that would be a Cockhammer, that would completely swing the board here. So that's one of the options. And it also makes a good turn with the Fan of Knives on turn 6 with the second agent. And the Azure Drake is not needed at that point, because the main purpose of playing Azure Drake is to boost backstabs, right? Yeah. Oh, he goes for the Sap. That's interesting.
Sap Edwin?
And this is something I didn't anticipate at all, because the Edwin on 4/4, okay, he doesn't go for the Edwin.
Yeah, I think that's too dangerous, because then just True Silver just shuts you down so hard.
You would have to play the backstab, but then the backstab kills just only 1/1.
Yeah.
And I suppose next turn he has backstab SI Fan, potentially. Or backstab SI Edwin.
Well, he also has a Drake backstab, which is really powerful.
But even just getting Edwin out as a 6/6, it's going to be nice.
Yeah, true.
But the positive thing for JJ here is he saw a very early Blade Flurry as well, so he can maybe a bit more adventurous with building up the board with those mid-range minions that he has and feel a little bit safer.
I'm really surprised by this Sap. I'm just valuing, when you play Rogue, of course the tempo matters a lot, but at the same time, you know that there are some minions in the Paladin, like Belchers, like Tyrion, that just require the Sap.
Yeah.
Or otherwise, you rely on Eviscerates and Blade Flurries, and you already use the Blade Flurry, and you don't have the Eviscerates in hand.
Yep.
So I'm really surprised by the fact that he used the Sap.
Yeah, the thing is, in using Sap, he gained a lot of tempo. If you look at this board without looking at the player's hands, he's doing really well. But is this the point where you equality and muster? Just clear?
I think so.
Do you have to?
I just think it's too good, right? Do you want to leave any minions on the board?
No.
Because oil's a thing, right? Yeah. So if you say Aldor Peacekeeper, the 6/6, and an oil comes down, well, suddenly Van Cleef is still a threat. Whereas this just feels really clean. You get the muster on board. It does get cleared up by Fan of Knives, but then that's 3 mana of your opponent's turn. And the rogue only has 4 cards, 5 on the draw. So
yeah,
and you've
right,
seen a prep. So like prep Fan of Knives into more crazy stuff. Like just statistically, like shouldn't be that possible to happen this turn.
Yeah, and you've seen a lot of 3 mana minions as well. So if there is a Fan of Knives, there will be only 4 mana remaining. If there is no Violet Teacher, what do you play? And it actually is in Colenso's hand. The 5 drops that you want to play, but then you will not be able to play Fan of Knives. But maybe still, like, you just ignore Fan of Knives. Play a 5 drop, you weapon up, you kill one of the 1/1s. How afraid are you of Quartermaster?
Probably very afraid at this point, because you've used a Blade Flurry, and you can't like Drake Fan of Knives to clear, because they're going to be on 3 health. So I just don't mind Fan of Knives and daggering up. Like, just getting ready for next turn.
Yep, I agree.
Because the Fan of Knives might draw into something decent as well. You might draw a Violet Teacher, which although like feels bad, is still putting it down when your opponent only has a 1 attack weapon on board.
It's not a tempo play. That's why I probably prefer Lotheb. Yeah. You are weak to Quartermaster, but on the other hand, Quartermaster will only just kill Lotheb and doesn't put that much pressure on board.
This is going to be pretty nice. We're going to see the Shredder into the Peacekeeper.
The problem is you leave a minion board, which can be poisoned. Can be oiled up.
I suppose here though, like with your board on your side, other than a big flurry, then you can like just kill Lotheb next turn. So it will get the +3, which is still only a 4/5. It's just a Yeti, right? So it's not going to do anything too crazy. So you with the Shredder, you know, the 3/3 weapon, the odds on you killing it next turn are pretty high, especially combined with the Keeper of Ulduman in hand. You can just drop it down to a 3/3 if needed.
That's true. Oh, a second Blade Flurry. Now this will make a huge difference.
Yeah, because he has so many weapon buffs. So even though Tyrion is coming, Tyrion will be dangerous. And that's another Doomsayer.
Well, that's
That's if only he could have killed it this turn.
If he had a second backstab.
Yeah, that would have been huge. No, did you say you wanted 8 mana for Tyrion?
He knows that one sap was used, so I think you just slam Tyrion and just pray that there's no second sap.
If there was no saps played, you would probably just Shredder, either mini bot hero power or play Keeper.
Definitely.
But yeah, you've seen one, you just have to play for those odds.
And now Kulenko might gamble on sprint into sap, and it's the chances on getting the sap
reasonable,
are decent.
Yeah.
I think he's around 14 cards left. He has around 40 cards left in the deck, so having four draws for 14, one on 14, one on 13, one on 12, and one on 11, that doesn't seem so bad.
I'm wondering if because he can actually clear Tyrion and keep the Drake alive oiled up with Flurry, is that not going to be better?
Is it? Yeah, actually, is it
because
better?
He can poison, oil, and then the spell power.
Exactly.
Clears off Tyrion with the Flurry. Kills off the aspirant, so reduces your opponent down a mana as well, and you have an empty board with just your 4/7, 7/4. I'm sorry.
And you still have you can weapon up next turn, but that minion will be uncontested. There will be an Ashbringer.
If Ashbringer goes into the attack minion, okay, that's 14 damage. Your opponent's only on 21.
But the problem is you're getting pretty low.
You're getting 11, but you're playing versus midrange paladin.
I don't know if I would have been so greedy with that, you know?
Huh. I suppose the minion play is actually pretty okay here, because we've seen have we seen a Consecrate yet? We've seen the Equality, definitely.
Yeah, we've seen Equality.
Yeah.
So, you know, these minions are pretty durable once Equality is off the table.
Two Pillager, by the way.
I think this is a turn when Paladin has to be be changing into a phase deck, and you just attack.
Well, he didn't tap Tyrion.
Yeah, so you just attack phase.
He doesn't have it. He didn't sap Tyrion, so he just doesn't have it. So you just play Boom and go all out.
Well,
and
I like
and
it.
He does that. Yeah, that's really what I like about this turn. Just deal as much damage as possible.
But also now, if he wants...
Violet Teacher is very awkward to
if
help
he wants
with
to
the,
clear, then Flurry Boombots. The Boombots can do wonderful things, as we've seen already.
He has an 8, so it's possibly lethal right now with the Boombots.
Yeah. I'm sure that's already GG, man.
Yeah,
awesome. Already GG. I have seen this. This is pre-recorded.
This has happened.
This is pre-recorded. The bombs will do 8 damage to the face.
So he can go for the faceplate that we anticipated before, but now with Violet Teacher, actually the oil can land on one of the tokens. And we're going to see a couple of tokens. The tokens are good in a way that the bombs might actually not go to face.
Here we go, where's the oil going?
All right, and Kulenko,
wow. That's actually very important.
And he has the spell power.
Yeah, that's
so the Flurry's going to clear off the boom as well.
So now the bombs, where will the bombs hit?
Or do you just do you Flurry without attacking? Yeah, you do, right?
You attack.
Oh, okay.
Oh, you attack first and then you Flurry for the 100% kill, I guess?
Oh, this is lethal.
Yeah.
Oh. Okay.
Well, it might be a draw.
And that's the bomb.
Might be a draw.
What? There is face.
Oh, so close.
Wow, that was amazing. That was amazing.
I mean, the backstab draw was a really huge deal.
Yeah.
And the fact that he actually hit Violet Teacher hit with the oil.
That was perfect.
Yeah, on the
minion. That was exactly 6 damage to attack into Tyrion without risking the bombs killing your minions. Because he could just Flurry for the kill, 100% kill, instead of just Flurry first
and hope.
Clear. Yeah, and hope that my minions actually survive and then we'll be able to finish the game.
But we're going to see the rogue mirror.
Yes.
Who is the better rogue?
Well, let's see who's starting. And JJ is starting. That's kind of annoying when you're playing the mirror. You always want to have that coin.
Yeah.
One more card.
His hand is pretty mediocre, if not quite bad. The prep's always nice for Kulenko.
Kulenko has also 2 4 drops, which is very important. And he has the second coin with the pillager.
So guys, let's let's talk about the differences, because this is a mirror match. Mirror match is mostly 50-50, but there are differences. There's Tomb Pillager for Kulenko. JJ was playing Belcher. What is the most important in this matchup? A coin, obviously, you want to have the coin. What else? What is going to decide this game?
Blade Flurry. That's the most important card in the entire game, because it allows you to clear the board after Violet Teacher is being spawned on board, because you need to have that board control. This is why you play Agent on turn 3.
Yeah,
this is why you play Farseer without any kind of effect on board. This is why you have to get a minion as
I also think as well the prep for Kulenko is pretty huge, because also the person who preps sprints first is so far ahead, just because they can draw into like all the, these ball control, like the flurry, and even the fan of knives or anything like that to clear up. Yeah, the saps as well. Like it's really huge. Backstep's a pretty good pickup actually.
Yeah, he won't be able to play.
It allows him to kill the Violet Teacher, and that's quite a huge deal because you don't have any kind of board clear.
Yeah, and the next turn you can go Drake into Lotheb if it feels like it. Lotheb, again, another key card in this match, because you almost say Lotheb can then gain another turn because the Rogue's never going to do anything too crazy with just minions.
But there is the Tomb Pillager. It's going to have a showing in this matchup.
And it's actually a great card after you saw it on Eviscerate.
Yeah.
And the 5-4 stat is normally not really liked, but the 5-4 stat kills.
Oh my god, that backstab. That backstab was amazing.
The second backstab was such a huge deal.
Yeah,
and JJ's drawn into a sap as well, so the next minion that comes down is probably just going to get thrown back again.
Unless it's
I just think it would be a low tap, you know?
That's one way to get around sap.
Yeah. And it challenges the Azure Drake. The opponent will have to tank 5. That's the only way to kill the Lotep. Yeah. So I think Lotep is the way to go.
And you will be able to coin Dr. Boom after this. So yeah, it's not bad. Like Lotep provides you something to fight the board.
Are we just going to see the trade into JJ's Lotep now?
Yeah, the problem is JJ will be behind after the turn when Dr. Boom will be played. That's the problem.
This game is so interesting.
He'll be ahead for... Oh, he's just going face. Okay.
Because Lotheb still has to trade. Like, Lotheb cannot go for face.
Now the Lotheb just stalled to Dr. Boom for one turn because coin is for 5 mana.
But there is preparation Eviscerate. It's so amazing that he actually got Eviscerate now.
I'm not sure if you're joking or...
Oh, no, there's Lotheb. Okay. Yeah, it wasn't red. So I was like, what is happening? Oh, Lotheb's trolling casters all the time.
The prep would have good value if you could pair it up. So I think JJ has to drop the Azure Drake here to just have some decent chances of cleaning up the board. But he goes for the certainty instead of gambling on the draws. And chooses to
play this sap. I think this is okay. Because even now we can see like Dr. Boom would like to come down now, but...
That's already 9 damage.
Yeah, that's the problem.
That's
JJ's got a lot of power.
Second prep. Can he take advantage of that? Well, he can eviscerate Lotep, which is a great deal. And well, he's missing Deadly Poison. That would be the MVP card in this situation to just to clear the agent, worry about the oil.
Yeah, he doesn't have enough spells. That's the problem. And if Colenso loses this game, it's over for him. He's eliminated. Same for JJ, though, as well. Oh man, this came down to a Rogue Grove Mirror.
For JJ, the most important card would be Blaze Flurry right now. Now look at that.
Guys, we honestly don't know this is going to happen. Oh, we're just so good at calling the cards. I mean,
wow.
If only we could do this when we're laddering.
Caster Curse.
Well, I could really do with this card now, draw.
It's so great with the spell damage, just healing everything here. 7 to face.
Without the Blade Flurry, as I said at the beginning of the game, Blade Flurry is the MVP of this match because otherwise you always use those cards like Eviscerate and Backstep to just take control back of the table, but Blade Flurry alone is just so important.
Okay. Colenso is not dead yet.
Colenso uses the second prep, which is an insane tempo move right now. Otherwise, this would have been over already.
JJ can pick up something. Like Eviscerate to win.
And that's it. JJ advances. Oh, he's so happy. The determination on his face is good. The German determination.
He got it.
And Colenso. No salt.
Colenso is just, well, I guess I lost. Eviscerate. It was a great game, though, and a great match.
Yep.
We had so many back and forth. Paladins being strong and...
Wow, that was a really close match. The fact that the Blade Flurry was drawn for JJ, that was the moment when he had the game back on his side. Even though the differences between the damage was so vast, like Colenso had had to do 24 damage to win the game, it was still very close because JJ was running out of answers.
Yeah.
And the fact that he had a prep in his hand was just clogging his end auto if he wouldn't have a sprint in there.
Whereas on the other side, Colento had Dr. Boom and he had prep sprint himself, actually, by that point in the game. So if he did just stabilize one more turn, refills his hand again, and then you've got all the answers.
And to deal 24 damage with Rogue isn't really that hard when you have a Dr. Boom, two bombs, and most likely a oil in there, and then maybe a blade through, and just dish out tons of damage.
So even though it didn't look that close, it was actually pretty close, and there was a couple of clutch cards. And it's a great victory for JJ. You know, he is continuously proving himself. He won the Story Cup, he won a couple of other tournaments, and now he went for the qualifier to face Colento here. He won versus Sivka, which he really wanted previously. He wanted to face Colento. He won versus Colento, and now he's our first semi-finalist, so...
Yeah, everything's just going right for him, isn't it?
Absolutely, and he's playing great, and with Rogue as well. A lot of people wanted to see JJ playing Rogue, because it is his class, this is what he mostly streams. But at tournaments, he just couldn't bring it to the Conquest. It was a bad class, but suddenly, right now, it's amazing. It's doing great. Most of the Rogues in the top 16 actually made it to the top 8.
Yeah, that's a really good pick for current meta game. You can take advantage of playing against classes like Paladins with the Blade Flurry, right? And you can take also... Rogue is not that bad against Druid when it comes to
I think it's pretty
right?
okay, yeah.
It's kind of course, draw-dependent because you need those saps timed at a certain point of the game to just take the advantage of the tempo, especially if someone just double-innovates something. It's just so cute. But I really like that the Rogue is making comeback in the metagame at all.
Yeah, absolutely. Shaman as well. Shaman was
We might argue if people are happy with Shaman being back in the metagame.
What in the form it's in?
Strogs charging at you, elemental destruction, everything.
Yeah, I like the elemental destruction. That's what I like. So I really love the iteration with the elemental destruction. I don't like the iteration without it because it feels like so straightforward. There are some tricky decisions to make, but we'll see in the future games. Like Sixo is using the Shaman.
Yeah.
So we'll see that at some point. But first... Yeah, the second quarterfinal.
Right? The next quarterfinal is Legendarn versus Ness. So we are going to see Rogue again from Legendarn, who was playing it yesterday, and he played it beautifully. And Ness is playing Priest. So that will be a very interesting matchup. It seems like Legendarn has an advantage because Rogue is good versus Priest, but we have other decks as well. And Ness was able to win versus Freaky 3-0 with that Priest, and he won versus Rogue as well. So that is the match coming up next, but now we are going to take a short break. So stay with us, guys, and we'll be right back.